Following interview was conducted with Morgan Olsen, the Executive Vice President and Treasurer for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Thursday, September 4th, 2008, in Stewart Center. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you.
And tell us a little bit about where you were born and your parents in early years and high school, et cetera.
Sure, absolutely. I was born in Fargo, North Dakota, but really grew up in Bismarck, North Dakota. Went to school there. My parents are Richard T. Rigg Olsen and my mother, now deceased, Nancy Jo Olsen, raised me in Bismarck along with my brother Blair, who is about 2.5 younger than I am. And as I said, I spent my early years growing up in Bismarck. It was a great place to grow up, a great quality of life. We had a lot of fun, spent a lot of time outdoors, you know, catching frogs, going fishing, playing football and hockey and tennis, you name it. So it was a good childhood.
What was how large was the high school? Were you in any activities there? Or,
oh, quite a few, actually. Okay, a lot of people assumed that it was a small high school, and it actually wasn't. And until my junior year, there was actually only one public high school in Bismarck. And my graduating class, even though they split after my sophomore year into two public high schools, my graduating class was still about 440 people. So yes, we had all kinds of activities and opportunities, and as part of that good childhood that
right.
I referred to.
Then where'd you go to college? Tell us about college life and where you went and activities and the professors, et cetera.
Sure. Yeah, my first two degrees are from the University of North Dakota in Grand Forks, North Dakota. I received a bachelor's degree in political science from UND in 1980. And in 1982, I earned a master's degree in public administration, also from UND.
Okay. What was college life, and did you live on campus? And were you in any activities or fraternities?
I was fairly active. I did live on campus most of the time that I was at UND. I think maybe the last year or two that I moved off campus with a friend to an apartment. But you know, it's something I often talk to my staff and certainly students about now, about the value of living on campus, certainly from a extracurricular and a social standpoint, but it also has been proven out many times in academic studies, you know, that students who live for at least a couple years on campus do better academically in terms of grade point average. They graduate at a higher rate, they graduate faster, and I lived that early on. I was involved in, you know, student government, student senate, a number of clubs. I played a little bit of intramural hockey while I was there, and was not in a fraternity. I had a lot of friends who were, and actually was a legacy a couple of different places, but ultimately decided that, you know, for me it was okay just to kind of be involved in a lot of different organizations as opposed to picking one
right.
specifically.
Okay, what year did you graduate then, and then what came next?
Well, undergraduate was 1980, and I went directly into a graduate program in public administration. I was at the time interested in doing an internship with the North Dakota Legislative Assembly, and it was almost more of that, the draw of that, that got me started with my master's program. I found I enjoyed it, but I did the internship, finished up my master's degree in public administration in 1982, and had the opportunity while I was there to work for the Bureau of Governmental Affairs, which was a research bureau that University of North Dakota has, even to this day, I believe, that takes a look at state government. And I had a couple of projects where I was working for the North Dakota Legislative Council, which is sort of the support entity, the research arm for the legislature there, looking at the one was to review and update the history of North Dakota state agencies, and the other one was a handbook that legislators and people in state government and businesses used on the structure of North Dakota state agencies. So at least at that time, some 30 years ago, I knew a little bit about both the history and the structure of North Dakota state government.
Then tell us what came next. Were there any military service? Would you serve in the at all or not?
No, I was one of those people who kind of hit, you know, in between the...
No reserves or anything like that?
No reserves. That sort of passed me by, but I was thinking about going to law school when I finished my public administration master's degree, but had an opportunity to go to work for the North Dakota Office of Management and Budget. It sort of grew out of those experiences that I shared with the Legislative Council and the Bureau of Governmental Affairs, and so went to work in the State Budget Office, and I did that for about 5 years. and I was, I don't know if it should be described as being in the right place at the wrong time or the wrong place at the right time, but a long story short, I had a lot of opportunity to have a pretty high level of responsibility early on in my career, which really culminated in a stint that I served as the interim legislative budget analyst, executive budget analyst, which basically meant that
for the state, which basically meant that
I was in charge of the staff that helped put together the governor's budget that he presented then to the legislature. And so at that early point in my career, that was certainly a lot of responsibility, and I think I probably got about 15 years of experience in that five that I mentioned.
Were you married at the time, Brett?
I wasn't, which was a darn good thing. I don't know how I would have had time to do it at the time.
Sure.
But I did meet my then future wife, who also is a native of North Dakota, mm-hmm. and was living in Bismarck at the time. And so by the time I left there to kind of embark on my higher education career, we had decided to get married, and did in December of 1985.
Good. Okay. Now let's talk a little about your career path before you came to Purdue. Tell us a little bit about some things that you did.
Sure. Uh-huh. Well, one of the experiences I'd had when I was at UND was I had an opportunity to serve on the North Dakota State Board of Higher Education, which is the governing board for all the higher education institutions in the state.
Is it similar to our higher education here in Indiana?
It really isn't. It's a little bit. It's a governing board,
right.
But it has responsibility for governance of all the public universities in the state of North Dakota. So it's not a sole institution governing board. And I was a student representative on that board for a couple of years, and learned an awful lot in that time period. That was while I was in graduate school, and it gave me, I guess, an interest in continuing to work in higher education. And it's like a lot of things in life. You know, you see it from one context and from a little bit from a distance, and you think you know what it is, but of course you only know a certain piece of it. But anyway, so I'd spent some time working for the Office of Management and Budget, and really thought that it would be great to work in higher education. And so I ultimately had that opportunity. And so in the fall of 1985, I left Bismarck, North Dakota, and moved to Emporia, Kansas, where I went to work as a business manager. Was my first title there for Emporia State University, which at that time was probably around 7,000 students.
It's an old institution. It's been around for a long time.
1863, if memory serves.
There's that famous newspaper from Emporia that
absolutely
still goes.
The Emporia Gazette and William L. White, and then William Allen White might have the order on those
two
reversed.
Anyone in journalism knows that, right?
Exactly. I mean, very, very, very famous journalists, and the Gazette is there to this day. So anyway, I went to Emporia State, and I ended up working there for almost 10 years.
Oh, good. Okay. Did you take any graduate work while you were there, or not, or just work there?
I actually did. In fact, I just heard from my boss there the entire time that I was there, a fellow by the name of Bob Glennon, now long retired, who was the president of Emporia State, hired me there. And one of the things he told me is, Morgan, you need to get your doctorate. And I thought, well, that's sort of interesting, but are you sure I really need to do that? You know, I think I have the skill set that I need for what I'm doing as a chief business officer. But he really insisted that I do that. Not only insisted, but he also facilitated it. I had a pretty responsible position the whole time that I was there, but he said, you know, we'll work with you, we'll make this happen. And so what I did is I would commute in the afternoons to the University of Kansas, which is in Lawrence, Kansas, about 85 miles from Emporia, would attend either one or two doctoral courses in a given day, depending on the semester. And then during part of the time that we lived there, my wife had finished a master's degree while we were at Emporia State, and she decided she wanted to work in a larger school environment in more of an urban school district. So she went to work as an English teacher at Highland Park High School in Topeka, Kansas. And of course, Topeka was the grounds for the famous Brown v. Board of Education case with respect to knocking down the separate but equal doctorate, and so there's a lot of history there, and she worked with a largely minority community there, but we lived then for 4 years in Topeka. So then I would commute home from Lawrence to Topeka, which is another 35 miles, so I'd do this big, you know, triangle every day, 60 miles in the morning to Emporia, 85 to Lawrence, and then 35 back home. And so It was Beth and I at the time, and you know, we knew why we were doing it, i.e. the PhD program, but we largely communicated by Post-it notes on the kitchen cupboards. And so it's a good thing we didn't have children at that point, but ultimately, to, I guess, get to your initial question, I did end up earning a PhD in higher education, I think was awarded in 1992, if memory serves.
All that work, the end was in sight all along, you know, just keep chugging away.
Indeed it was. Well, and let me tell you, after about, you know, four years of coursework while working full-time, you know, Beth was providing encouragement by assuring me that she would kill me if I didn't finish my dissertation. And I think she meant it, and, you know, I'm here to tell a story, so obviously I did finish it.
You listened to what she said, right?
I always listen to what Beth tells me.
Oh, then after you finished that, what is that when you came to Purdue, or was there something prior to that?
I had several other stops before that. In fact, I kind of used to refer to my career as bumping around in the Midwest, and I'll expand on that a little bit. I spent almost 10 years at Emporia State. We had a great experience there. I worked for a great boss.
Did school grow over time since you
It did. It grew, and then actually has gotten smaller since I left. No correlation, I'm sure. But it was, I think, about 7,300 students when I left, and I left to go to Eastern Illinois University in Charleston, Illinois. I was there for about 5 years as vice president for business affairs. I'd left Emporia State finally as vice president for fiscal affairs, so I took a similar job at a larger institution there. Probably the most interesting thing about Eastern Illinois was that when I interviewed there for the job, they told me that there was a possibility the legislature might change the governance structure for public higher education in the state. They had always had it was known as the system of systems. There were basically four major public university systems in the state, and they said, you know, there's a possibility the legislature will change that so that most universities have their own institutional governing boards. And I remember thinking to myself at the time, oh yes, and the sun will probably begin rising in the west fairly soon as well. But sure enough, I accepted the job. By the time I got there, this had happened and been signed into law. And so during about the first year and a half that I was there, we had the opportunity, I describe it now, to sort of develop a governance structure and figure out how we're going to do all kinds of things almost from scratch. It was almost like a new institution.
For the institution.
For Eastern Illinois University, because before there had been a lot of things. They had about a 30-member staff in the Board of Governors office previous to that, and they all went away. And, you know, we, as things political sometimes work, you know, we kept waiting for some guidance from somebody. You know, what should we do, and how should we do it? It wasn't forthcoming. And so finally, I guess we kind of woke up one morning, and I thought to myself, you know, Morgan, this probably is not a very good career move at the first meeting of your new Board of Trustees on January 1 to say, oh, by the way, you have no insurance. So we just started doing things and developed it over time, and professionally it was a really good opportunity to work through all that. So I spent about 5 years there and have to this day a lot of very good friends there. Again, a wonderful experience there. Our older girl, who is now 16, Kiri, was born when we were in Kansas, but was very little when we moved. So, you know, she remembers starting school in Charleston, Illinois, and still maintains some contact with a few of her little friends there.
Good.
So from there, I moved to Dallas, Texas. That was where I sort of diverged from bumping around the Midwest. We spent 5 years there from I guess it would have been 1999 to 2004, and I was vice president for business and finance there. Of course,
is that University of Texas?
Southern Methodist University.
Oh, okay, SMU.
and SMU, of course, the private university, was my first and to date only private university experience. Again, a lot of great people. We loved Dallas. Very different from any place else we'd ever lived. You know, about 5 million people in the metropolitan area, and
it's a big jump from Charleston.
Oh my, yeah, Charleston was about 12,000 people, so it was a huge change. But you know, we liked the university, we liked the quality of living there, all the opportunity it had to provide, and so spent 5 years there. Worked for again a great president, Gerald Turner, there, and I guess that's kind of one of the things that, as I think about my career thus far, I think we've enjoyed every place we've ever been and have had a good experience there. And so, you know, it's always exciting to have a new opportunity, but at the same time, it's bittersweet, you know, because you're leaving you know, the friends and colleagues that you've developed, and the ones that are you know, truly close, you maintain. But it's a very different context. You don't see them as often. And SMU was like that, but had the opportunity to come to Purdue as executive vice president treasurer in 2004. And we ultimately decided that was a good thing to do.
And here we are in Lafayette, right?
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about some of your things for the researchers, the leadership and the challenges that you had, and also some of the capital projects that like Discovery Park, some of which I think were may have been underway when you came.
Yes, some of each. You know, certainly there has been the largest period of investment in the capital infrastructure of Purdue in its history during, let's say, the last 8 years or so. You know, much of that coincided, of course, with Martin Jiskie's time as president of Purdue, and that was certainly underway. But as I was taking a look at it, we will have done pretty close to $500 million or $500 million worth of capital projects during the time I've been here as executive vice president treasurer. So certainly
it's
one of the
completely transformed the whole layout of it.
Well, people tell me that, yeah. And you know, I always say to alumni, if you haven't been here in the last 5 years, you really don't know Purdue anymore, because it's changed the face of the place. Obviously, Discovery Park is one major factor, but you know,
even the Research Park, people remember how small that was, and that's been around for a long time.
Exactly,
another name
since 1961. But you know, we have 150 companies there, employing about 3,000 people today,
right,
in the Research Park. We have completely transformed the dining services for students on the West Lafayette campus, you know, consolidating from 12 individual dining halls in residence halls down to the now five dining courts that are just marvelous in terms of the opportunities they provide for students. And you know, we've done that largely with cost savings that came with economy of scale from doing that, and most importantly, we've improved the services to students. So yeah, an awful lot of infrastructure investment over the last 5 years.
Right, exactly. One of the things I was going to ask you about, that deferred maintenance in the campus facilities, that's something that's, you know, people have been talking about. I'm thinking of things the researchers might, if I say that term, they may not understand it, so you might just address what the deferred
sure.
maintenance for the people.
Well, what people really do understand is when a roof leaks, or when the air conditioning system doesn't work, or the sidewalk is broken, or the, you know, lab benches are non-functional. And that's been a major initiative over probably the last 3-4 years. And you know, what happened is at one point Purdue had what I like to refer to as the one-legged stool strategy, i.e. the legislature was to provide capital appropriations for repair and rehabilitation, or R&R, as it's also sometimes known. Mm-hmm. And of course, what happened is, like most states across the country, as the state had some financial difficulties, they were looking for things to do to reduce their costs. And I think Indiana has done a very creditable job of supporting higher education over the years. We haven't seen the kind of substantial reductions that they have all around us. Well, you know, whether you want to look to Illinois or Ohio or Michigan or a lot of other places, but one of the things they did do was substantially reduce those R&R appropriations. And at that time, there was really nothing else to go to. And so, what do? You just defer all that work. And it's a little bit like, you know, the old Mr. Goodwrench commercial: "You pay me now, or you pay me later." Well, what happened is all this maintenance was being deferred, and what started out as a leaky roof all of a sudden became much worse because water would infiltrate and create collateral damage, etc. So we knew we had to make a change.
It grows.
It grows all by itself.
Right.
So we knew we had to make a change, and we've now gone to what I like again to refer to as a multi-legged stool strategy. So that one of the legs of the stool, the funding sources, doesn't materialize in a given year, you know, you may be sitting a little bit crooked, but you don't fall off the stool. And so we now have a student fee that we were successful in getting the Board of Trustees to approve. It started out at $250 a year to support R&R. We reallocated some university reserves while that ramped up, because it only applied to new students as they started. We have also built some money into our operating budget for R&R as well, so that we have a little bit more control there. And we've tried to find ways to interest donors in projects. Pretty hard. Not too many donors are interested in putting in a new electrical subsystem for you. But you know, a project like Forney Hall of Chemical Engineering was one where not only did we add space, but we rehabilitated a lot of the space that was there. And in the process, we removed a lot of the deferred maintenance. And so you can look for those opportunities and piece together some of these projects with multiple funding sources. And we've, to date, as we sit here today, identified about $140 million worth of funding that's in place to address this deferred maintenance. And you know, if I know you've probably been around the West Lafayette campus for a while. I suspect you can tell a difference. For example, you know, the day classes end in May, the trucks move in, we spend all summer addressing that, and then we get out and are ready for classes in late August.
Yeah, good planning and well orchestrated. Talk a little bit about, for the researchers, the budget. There's an operating and the capital budget, and you submit that to the board, and then it goes forward.
We do, yeah. We're, you know, as a public university, of course, an important constituency for us and a major funding source is the state of Indiana. Right. And so there's a process for submitting both our operating budget request, which supports our yearly annual activities, you know, teaching and research and administration and student services and those activities. And there's also a capital budget, which is where we request funds from the state that are used to make investments in our buildings and our built environment. And so we start by submitting those budget recommendations as an administration to the Board of Trustees. We have a biennial or two-year budget process in the state of Indiana, so they would approve those in the spring of the even-numbered year, as we sit here today in 2008. They then go on to the Indiana Commission for Higher Education, and then ultimately on to the governor, and the governor makes his recommendation to the legislature, and ultimately they put together a budget in their odd year or long budget session year. So 2009 will be a longer budget session again, and then the fiscal year would start July 1 of that odd numbered year. July 1, 2009 through June 30 of 2011 will be the next biennium, two fiscal years.
Right, very good. Okay. Now you serve as the treasurer for the Board of Trustees. You want to make a couple comments what that entails for the people who study
sure.
the university?
Well, it's I think maybe the most important thing I can say about it is it's really an honor. And
it depends what you are. I mean, that's part of that within your bailiwick.
Absolutely, but it's interesting. You know, as executive vice president, you know, you report to the president of the university, right. But you also have this responsibility to the board of trustees as treasurer. It is a board corporate officer that they elect, and they, you know, they go together. So you really have those two constituencies to serve simultaneously. Now, the good news is that. You know, that doesn't end up being a tug of war. Generally, you know, you serve the good of the university, and so they're working together, and I've looked at it as a true privilege and an honor to be able to do that here.
Right. Exactly. Okay. One Purdue. You got your three modules, and that certainly has made a significant change.
It really has.
And a lot under your watch.
Well, that was one of the things that. Was definitely on the plate when I was talking about coming here, and I had the opportunity to do what is often referred to as an ERP or Enterprise Resource Planning project while I was in Dallas, and so I had some experience with it, enough experience, you know, that I and others wondered, well, why in the world would you want to do that again? Because they're hard. What it really involves is you replace all the major computer systems that help support the operations of the institution. You know, typically it would involve all of your financials, budgeting and accounting, payroll, et cetera, would involve your human resources, the personnel system, and all the things that go along with that, and then your student systems right. that support functions
three
like
major.
Registration and admissions and financial aid and student receivables. So, you know, we've done that successfully on time and on budget. But I always, you know, with the project team and my staff, I always use the analogy that it's a little bit like overhauling the engine in your car at the same time that you're driving 60 miles an hour down the highway. You know, because none of the stuff that these systems support can stop. You know, the university has to continue to operate. You need to be able to, you know, pay employees and provide, you know, course registrations to students, et cetera, et cetera. And so it's highly complex. It's not always a lot of fun.
It's a big challenge.
It's a big challenge, but I'm so proud of the people, you know, who not only worked specifically on the project team, and there were probably about, from time to time, as many as 135 people on the project team, but also the people who were in the offices, you know, that performed the operational functions, working together, you know, doing testing and making sure that it was implemented properly. All of that had to go on at the same time they were doing their regular duties. And
right.
and so I'm just really proud of the job that Purdue and Purdue's people did on that. You don't have to look too hard to see examples, certainly of other universities, but other types of organizations that have had serious difficulties. You know, couldn't provide financial aid to students, weren't able to pay their employees, couldn't get their books to balance and put together financial statements at the end of the fiscal year. You know, none of those awful things happened here. Now, you know, do we have more work to do? Absolutely. You know, it's a process of continuous improvement. There are things that we know can be better than they are today, and they will be.
Right.
But by and large, you know, people got it done.
Right. Is there a similar, do other, any other universities have the similar thing that does this, that we have here?
They do. In fact, Purdue actually was probably one of the later universities, for example, we always looked at the Big Ten for
sure.
Obvious reasons, that we're probably one of the later implementers in the Big Ten. And part of the reason for that is because it's very expensive and because it's hard and it's not fun.
That's right.
But
you know, bite the bullet and move with it.
Exactly. But we were able to get it done and basically finished up here in June. And you know, we're off to the races with the new systems, and they're working well, and we're busy focusing on okay, what do we want to improve next?
Tidying up a little bit, right?
Exactly.
One of the things, of course, that's made a big change is the university smoking, as in the cities too. But you chaired that committee after the Senate sent the report to Dr. Jeske. Any comments on that?
Absolutely. You know, I look at it, it's kind of a microcosm of social change. And I remember, for example, back to earlier in my career in higher education, to my first higher education job, and the president had a conference room there off of his office, and it was basically not much more than a converted power file room, you know. So it was very narrow. The ventilation wasn't that good. But back in those days, nobody thought anything about smoking. I mean, people just, you know, you'd have these two-hour...
You could smoke in the classroom.
Any place.
Years ago.
You know,
people have been.
And not just cigarettes either. We had some people who loved cigars. And so you're sitting in this room. I literally had to, about every 30 minutes, I had to leave the room, go out in the hall and breathe, you know, for a few minutes before I could come back. And, you know, at the time, that was the social accepted norm. Of course, we know a lot more about the health impacts these days and about personal comfort and that type of thing. And so, you know, that's changed over time, and the first thing that happened is, you know, you couldn't smoke places like classrooms and in meetings and that sort of thing. But we've sort of evolved to the point where, you know, it is more commonly accepted, you know, that smoking should not interfere with the rights of others who either choose not to smoke or have specific health conditions which make it very dangerous for them to be around smoke. And so that's, you know, that was kind of where this came in, and you know, it was time for Purdue to make that change.
It had been studied for a period of time.
It had been studied for a while.
Which is natural.
Exactly, right? Exactly, you know, because you want to balance, you know, right, people's rights. And in our climate, of course, what we're saying to people now is, well, you can only smoke outside, and you have to be 30 feet away from any of the buildings. You know, that's one thing in August, and another thing in February. In our climate, there, of course, our institutions are saying not only may you not smoke inside, you may not smoke on campus at all. Now, Purdue West Lafayette has not done so yet. They just did that at Purdue North Central campus, and so I think, you know, probably as that evolves and societal expectations change, that may come here as well. And, you know, I know this interview is a little bit about preserving Purdue history, and one piece of Purdue history that's pretty interesting, you probably are aware that the black wrought iron look fences that are on campus were initially there, they were called smoking fences. And the reason, yes, the reason is that the rule was that you could not smoke inside that fence. And so what people would do is they would kind of lean up against the fence and lean over and have their cigarette.
That's so a piece I did not
if
know.
You
That's
talk
great.
To people in physical facilities and you refer to smoking fences, they know exactly what you're talking about. And the day may come again where they have that same function.
Let's talk a little about diversity. I think one of the things that I certainly would like to say is that new Catalyst Award that you're going to award tomorrow. That's very nice. And it's tied in with the diversity and other things too. So tell us a little bit about the award and also diversity that is on campus.
Sure. Well, we're really excited about that. You know, one of the things that is so wonderful about Purdue is that, you know, people are always ready to help, and they're enthusiastic and they like to be involved.
Right.
And this is one example under Martin Jiske's leadership. You know, one of the things that was held out as an important to-do was to improve the diversity of the campus. Diversity in terms of the makeup of the student body, diversity in terms of makeup of the employee base, diversity in terms of our academic programming, and diversity in terms of our supplier relationships.
Right, and that's the Office of Supplier Diversity, which
absolutely
came under your watch,
which,
right.
Which was started about 3.5 years ago.
Right.
But as it relates to the Catalyst Award, we created a Treasurer's Diversity Task Force about 3 years ago, and we were enlisting people from across Treasurer's area, a variety of job responsibilities, a variety of office locations, and asking them to help us think about diversity and how do we forward it? How do we get people comfortable with diversity in its many aspects? You know, there are all kinds of diversity, and we wanted to make sure that people view Purdue as a very inclusive, welcoming environment for all. And so that was sort of their charge, and said, you know, come up with good ideas. You know, you may borrow some, you may develop some yourselves. And one of the ideas that they came up with was that, you know, we want to find a way to preserve and publicize some of these good ideas, some of the things that people are doing. And it would be great to have an award that allowed us to showcase that just a bit. And so that was how the Catalyst Award, purposely named, the Catalyst Award was born. The idea is that it will allow people to show off what they think are good practices that promote and enhance diversity at Purdue. And so tomorrow we'll have the opportunity of awarding the first Catalyst Award to one of the seven finalists, and they went through a process where they made presentations and had displays, and arrived at a certain number of finalists, and ultimately we have now picked one inaugural Catalyst Award winner, which will be announced tomorrow. And we hope what happens is people look at some of the approaches and say, you know, that's applicable over here too. So that's the idea.
Good. Are they planning to do it on an annual basis, do you think?
I think so. Yes.
Okay.
This is the inaugural, and but we're hoping
we're
it's annual.
Members.
And it does come with in addition to all the glory you can stand. It comes with a $5,000 award that will go to the winning department for their use in new diversity initiatives.
Right. Tell us a little about that Office of Supplier Diversity, that which was a new office for the research that was on campus that, in your watch that started.
Yes. Yeah. That the Office of Supplier Diversity Development was established to allow us to be more supportive of minority and women-owned business enterprises. You know, Purdue has a huge annual spend. You know, our annual budget this year is about $1.8 billion across the system. The large majority of that is spent on personnel, but you know, we spend hundreds of millions of dollars a year on supplies and travel and services. What we wanted to do is to make sure that our supplier base is representative of the communities in which we live, and that we provide equal opportunities to minority and women-owned businesses. We were fortunate enough to be able to recruit Mr. Jesse Moore to serve in that role as the Director of Supplier Diversity Development. Jesse has a long background working in business development, working as a private businessman, working with chambers of commerce, including the State Chamber, the Indianapolis Chamber. He was the CEO for the Indianapolis Black Chamber of Commerce for a while. If there's a stranger to Jesse, it's only once. He's
very personable.
Very personable, and so that's been something that's been great. And you know, we've established a variety of areas that we watch in terms of our spend on consultant services, particularly architectural and engineering consultants, in terms of our capital project spend and our overall supplies and expenses spend. And you know, what we believe that we can help people develop their businesses. You know, the Small Business Administration, our Small Business Development Center, they're all partners along with others we don't have time to mention today. It's not a set-aside program, but rather a support mechanism so we can help people understand how to be most effective in terms of marketing to Purdue, make them aware of opportunities, help them understand the requirements for doing business with Purdue. And Jesse and Larry Furson in our purchasing area have both been great leaders in that. And so it's been nice to see that develop. And of course, what is measured tends to improve, and so that's why we have those metrics and watch that. And there's a real commitment across the university to broadening our supplier diversity.
Is it just within the state, or do they go outside the state as well?
We focus most of our efforts within the state, but of course we do business in probably every state in the union, and so certainly there's no intent to draw a circle around the state and say only operate in there. But at the same time, we, all of the things being equal, we love doing business in the state of Indiana.
Right, you focus there. The State Budget Committee, you interact with them, do you?
I do some,
okay.
Yes.
Go ahead. Just how you interact with them, just a couple comments on that.
Well, my staff handles a lot of that interface, but of course there are many things that by state law they're required to approve in the area of our capital projects. We have a fair amount of autonomy as a university through our board of trustees in the state, but one area where there is a lot of oversight by the state is in how we do our capital projects, building projects, and how they're financed, with oftentimes with bond issues or other types of borrowing. And so that's a very important relationship for us. They have to approve our capital projects, first the Indiana Commission for Higher Education, then ultimately the State Budget Committee, and we can't move forward until they do. And so a lot of times it's providing them with information and answering questions that they have to be able to approve these projects. Increasingly, these projects are not being funded by the state. We did a study over the last 7 years, and about 71% of the capital projects that we've had over that time period, the last 7 years, have been funded with other than state appropriations. In other words, they're coming from private gifts, they're coming from auxiliary enterprise revenue that we generate here on campus, or some source other than the state, which is an eye-opening number actually for a lot of people. But I think it tells you a little bit about the increasing diversity of support for public universities, including this state. On our operating budget, I mentioned the $1.8 billion operating budget this year, only about 18% of that is coming from state appropriations. So that means that 82 cents of every dollar that Purdue spends this year is coming from something other than a state tax appropriation.
Interesting, yeah. The regional campuses, what's your liaison with the regional campuses? They have business people, I imagine, there. Just a comment, because researchers know that there's the campus.
Well, they do, we have one board of trustees, and we have one treasurer, one corporate officer, and I'm the treasurer for, all four universities. We, I think, capture a lot of economy of scale by operating that way, and yet, we want to make sure that we balance that and that we have people that know best the local communities and the needs of the individual campuses with their unique programs and clientele as much as possible. So the way that works is the chief business officer on each of the three regional campuses that are part of the Purdue University system are joint reports. They report both the chancellor, who is the chief operating officer of that campus, and they report to the treasurer. And so that's kind of a way that we maintain those linkages. It certainly helps me understand better what the needs of each of the campuses are. It helps us make sure that we have good stewardship and accountability. And it also helps us maintain economy of scale. There are things, for example, that we can do well because we can afford to have highly specialized experts in some areas that you couldn't afford at a regional campus of 3,500 students or even 10,000 students. And so it's a nice mix, and there's always a little bit of tension there in terms of, okay, well, what's the right balance between, do this separately by yourself on the campus as opposed to, let's centralize this and do this one way in one place. But I think, by and large, it works quite well. And so it's really part of the treasurer's responsibility to be continuously evaluating that and most importantly, serving each of the Purdue University system campuses so that they can realize their missions and their strategic plans.
That's only North Central, Fort Wayne, and Calumet as your liaison. For the researcher, you might clarify, Indianapolis, it's different because of that. Is that the case?
Very, very much so.
I anticipate that they may wonder about that. Go ahead.
Well, it's a very interesting construct that's fairly unique, I think, across the country in public higher education, where we have the two campuses, IUPUI in Indianapolis and IPFW in Fort Wayne, where many years ago the presidents of the Purdue and Indiana University systems came together and said, look, we're both doing business in these two cities, we could continue to compete or we could collaborate. And of course they chose to collaborate, and they did that by way of establishing that these campuses would have programs and faculty from both Indiana University and Purdue University but they would be one campus and they would be governed by one board of trustees. And the way that was split up was Indianapolis is managed under a management agreement by the Indiana University Board of Trustees, and the Fort Wayne campus, same thing, but is managed by the Purdue University Board of Trustees. And yet there are programs and faculty from each of the university systems. I remember when somebody was explaining that to me a few years ago, I just said, there can't be any way in the world that that'll work. But the fact of the matter is that it does work quite well. I'm not entirely sure why all the time, but it allows for those communities to be very well served and have programs from each of the two major university systems in the state. And one of the things that the state, I think, of Indiana has done quite well is to have very specific missions for each of the universities, and particularly for Purdue and IU. You know, we have all engineering programs, and Indiana University doesn't have any. You know, we don't have music programs or architecture programs or law programs or medicine, and that's allowed the state to concentrate limited resources and yet not through this joint campus approach, not shortchange those large, you know, the two largest cities in the state of Indiana.
Right, very good. Now you've got a couple of awards. You were the past president of the Central Association. Tell us a little bit about that. And the past chair of the board of the National Association of College University Business Officers. Just a comment on the association and
sure.
The role in that.
Well, I've been involved in my primary professional associations for virtually all of my professional career, and I've always found it first and foremost a very good way to learn, and you develop a professional network. And I have friends all across the country now as a result of those experiences. It's probably had a little bit to do with some of the places that I have had the opportunity to work in my career. And I think it's been important to contribute to the profession a little bit. And of course, I had the opportunity to be president of the Central Association, which is basically the Midwest, and then to go on and serve on the board of the National Association, but then ultimately be chosen by my colleagues there to serve as the board chair, which is the top volunteer position for the National Association. And I think it's hard to think of a higher honor, you know, than to be picked by your colleagues to serve your professional association in that way. And the
it's
national
a compliment.
Yeah, well, it is, and so I'm flattered. At the same time, you know, it's a responsibility, and the National Association particularly has sort of this tripartite mission. You know, they're very much involved with professional development for the business officer profession. They're very involved in knowledge development. You know, times change, problems change. You know, what are the core knowledge, skill, and abilities that a successful business officer has to have? You know, and Google helps research and define that. And then finally, they also have a public policy mission. Of course, we know that at the national level, we're talking about Congress and the executive branch, and NACUBA was very much involved in advocating for higher education, particularly in the broad areas of business and administrative services, for appropriate regulatory and policy making, as well as the process of making laws, like the recently reauthorized Higher Education Act. And
right.
So the opportunity to be involved to some extent with that has really been great. It's actually a tradition at Purdue. Historically, the treasurer, executive vice president, treasurer of Purdue has often had the opportunity to be a national leader, and so I knew those people when I was elsewhere in my profession.
It was nice to have it for yourself.
Sure. Certainly for myself, but also, I think it advances the name of Purdue okay. University,
right.
Which is a big part of the value proposition
right.
too.
I got a couple things. Do you have a favorite Purdue tradition, and how about an outstanding event in your life?
Gosh, those are tough questions. I think Purdue is a place that is full of traditions. And there's talk about the Purdue family, and I think that's real. The sense of belonging that comes with that, and no matter where you travel, you say the name Purdue, not just in the United States, but around the world. That means something, and you've got something in common with over 350,000 people all over the globe. So there's certainly
that. It's an international tradition.
Absolutely.
Nice, right?
And of course, part of Purdue is that we've had one of the largest international student enrollments for years and years and years. Usually it's between 4,500 and 5,000 students annually. And
right. And
we now have not just second generation, but third generation Purdue students from other countries. So that's great. Big Ten football game days are hard to beat. So there are a lot of things, I guess, in terms of traditions. I'm kind of partial to the Lion Fountain,
That's nice. A lot
sits
of people,
it is campus.
Kind of a nice tradition.
It's beautiful.
So they brought it back to life again.
Absolutely. And if you're brave, you can actually drink out of it. Right.
Right.
Right. So so that would probably be a couple of things in terms of traditions. You know, in terms of outstanding events in my life, gosh, I hope there's some to come, I guess is what I would say, first of all.
But excellent answer.
You know, but I think probably the births of our two children. Beth and I have two girls, one 16 and one 6. And I can't imagine anything more important, I guess, than those days. You know, being a parent, especially to a teenager lately, is, you know, it's a privilege and a joy, but it's probably also, you know, your biggest challenge too, in terms of trying to do that even passably well, you know, so as not to you know, mess up another human life, because you want to see your, you know, your children do well. And so, you know, being a good dad, at the same time you try to do some of these other things, you know, for your university, is, you know, a challenge, but I think it's a real privilege.
Right. In closing, any closing remarks that you'd like to say, Dr. Olsen?
Well,
if you look back, you have to come back sometime. We'll do a follow-up.
Oh, trust me, I'd love to come back.
I put you on my list.
One of the things that happens, I think, is at least for me, is that you get very engaged in what you're, you know, what you're doing, what you're trying to do, and as you, you know, if you have an opportunity to do something else and you realize you're going to take it, you also think a little bit about, gosh, you know, I didn't finish this, and I know just what we need to do on this other thing, and you say, you know, I'm not going to be able to carry that ball now, to kind of use a sports analogy. You know, somebody else is going to have to run the next set of downs, you know, you get pretty loyal, pretty proprietary to the place, you know, it's been a, I guess I'd just say that, you know, it's been a real privilege to be here. It's been a thrill. You know, we've made a lot of friends,
which you'll take with you.
Yeah, exactly. And you have colleagues, you know, you just have to celebrate them in a different way.
That's right.
And we'll certainly do that. I feel like it's been a great professional opportunity to be here, a personal opportunity that we'll cherish. I just wish the best for Purdue going forward.
Good. Thank you very much, Dr. Olsen. Appreciate that very
absolutely
much.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Absolutely. Well.